Good morning and welcome to the second meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses on the Scottish Government's budget 2024-25. And our first panel today we're joined online by Councillor Katie Hagman, who's the resource spokesperson for COSLA, and in the room by Miran Kelly, who's the Chief Officer at Local Government Finance at COSLA, and David Robertson, who's the Finance Lead at Solus and the Chief Executive of the Scottish Borders Council. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And we'll try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate to the clerks. And Councillor Hagman, as you're participating virtually, if you could do that by typing R in the chat function. And I'd now like to begin by asking, and maybe I'll direct this to Councillor Hagman initially. The Deputy First Minister told the Parliament that the 2024-25 revenue settlement presents a 5% real terms increase compared to last year's budget. However, COSLA states that the settlement is actually a £62.7 million reduction over the year. And I would be, myself and the committee would be interested to understand how COSLA arrives at this figure and why it appears to be so different to the Scottish Government's interpretation. And a follow-on question is that we heard from the Director of Finances that the provisional 2024-25 budget allocation should actually be compared against the final budget figures for 2023-24.
Thank you. And, yeah, I appreciate being able to join you online this morning. Apologies, I'm not there in person. So, yeah, absolutely, there is a discrepancy in terms of the figures that are being discussed. And I appreciate that the Deputy First Minister, and I believe the Spice report has also indicated that there is an increase. However, as you quite rightly pointed out there, Convener, the Directors of Finance also pointed out that the comparisons are not exactly even as such. And I think it's fair to say that if we go back to the beginning of December, when COSLA launched our campaign, our budget lobbying campaign, we were very clear that in order to stand still, we needed an increase to our budget of around 14.4 billion, excuse me. And within that, we were very clear, it was stated that it was included the revenue settlement from last year plus the policy commitments. And my understanding is that those policy commitments haven't necessarily been captured throughout the year. And in part, this may be because we're not at the end of this financial year currently, so therefore it may not be possible. But, you know, there is certainly a discrepancy around that. COSLA leaders met on the 21st of December, and at that point we had our budget reality document published, which if members of the committee haven't seen or had access to, we can certainly provide that following the committee today. But that clearly shows where there is a shortfall within our revenue budget and, importantly, a significant shortfall in our capital. Clearly, I've got Miran, who's my chief financial officer, with me, and obviously we've got David here as well, so they may wish to come in maybe on perhaps more of the technical details on that.
Thanks very much, Katie. Miran, you want to come in?
Yeah. Thanks very much. And it is always complicated. So what our budget reality document does is try and set out how we get to that. So it's because the comparison made by DFM in Parliament is from the Scottish budget as published last year to this budget as published. So the differences, as Councillor Hagman mentioned, of things that have been added in year or commitments that are already known for next year are included in what makes it then appear to be an increase. So significantly over the 23-24 financial year, there have been substantial additional allocations to local government to support a pay award. So that's part of that total. So our point about where there is a a cut in terms of a real term, we've received 62.7 million less in revenue than we expected before you take into account any inflation. So in the budget reality document that we published on the 21st of December, the first table kind of sets that out. It sets out what we were expecting for pay, the baselining, and the fact that funding has been baselined in this year adds an additional complication to it. But we've set out what we expected to receive just as a flat cash before any before anything was taken into account. And the revenue total is 62.7 million short.
Okay. David, have you got anything to add?
I think just to say that you know, the funding has increased for local government, but so have the commitments, and that's the key issue. What we're being asked to do with the money based on government policy and distribution of funding has also increased, and what we're being asked to do with the money we have goes beyond a cash settlement plus inflation to fund those policy commitments, and that's where we end up with the almost £63 million of reduction in funding which local government's looking at.
Okay, thanks for that. Taking a longer term view, the Scottish Government informed the committee in November that local government revenue funding is 2.6% higher in real terms than it was in the year 2013-14, as confirmed by the recent Accounts Commission report. Around the same time, COSLA wrote to the Parliament's Economy and Fair Work Committee saying that over the past decade, local government has experienced significant cuts to funding. A 9.6% reduction in revenue funding from 2013-14 to 2020-21 was followed by further real-term reductions 2022-23 to 23-24. I'd be interested to hear how you account for the differences in interpretation.
I'm happy to pick that up. I believe that was some work that was done by Audit Scotland within a particular council where they did try and look at exactly the issue that David mentioned in terms of picking up where there's been additional money added in, but for the purpose of a specific policy, and therefore it's committed funding. It's not additional funding that can go to support everything else, compared to the real terms position.
Helpful. David, do you want to come in?
I think that's covered.
Okay, great. And so obviously, I mean, what we're trying to understand as a committee, and we had kind of considerable discussion around this, is that we've got various versions of reality. That was what was how it was described by the Director of Finance at Argyll and Bute Council last week. And it's difficult for the committee to really scrutinise the government's budget with these different versions. And it's also challenging for councils to make budget decisions. And I'd be interested to understand why there's such a disagreement over budget figures each year, despite COSLA and the Scottish Government committing now to work together. Katie?
I can come in on that one. I mean, absolutely, there is a commitment for us to work together. And I think certainly last year was my first time in this position going through the budget process. And, you know, there is often a different reality said by Scottish Government as what there is by local government. And that doesn't help anyone. And it least of all helps our communities, who then have a lack of trust, because who do they believe? So, you know, this was one of the main reasons and one of our huge drivers in taking forward the Verity House Agreement. Certainly within that, there was the ambition, and there still is the ambition, to work towards a fiscal framework. But I think it's fair to say that we are quite a distance away from the completion of that work, and the fact that we're still in the same position this year is disappointing. However, I think it is also fair to say we're less than a year, you know, into this partnership working, and it takes time, and it does take time to bed in. However, I think we absolutely must have a renewed commitment to accelerate that work. There was I think there was a few meetings earlier in the diary, but to say that there were significant discussions and that there was a no subsidies budget would be unfair, because that work hasn't yet been completed. But it is important that we continue on this journey, because absolutely, we must get to a point. And I think the fact that we're using different sets of figures, because obviously, as has been said many times, the figures that Scottish Government are publishing are not including the in-year costs that have come about within local government, least of all pay, which is going to be a significant issue going forward, I would imagine, this year ahead as well. So I think it is a challenge. And, you know, nobody's underestimating the financial challenges that Scottish Government are facing. We understand that, and that's even more important and imperative that we press ahead with this work so we can work collaboratively together.
Thanks very much for that. Any more to add?
David? I suppose we just really need to get to the point where we're ensuring that everybody's comparing apples with apples in terms of what we're looking at, and what COSLA do, what local government does, is compare the settlement to the settlement. So you're looking at the movement in a fixed point in time, and then any in-year commitments that have been made with based on new policies have to be added to that position in arriving at an assessment of whether there's flat cash or an increase or a decrease in terms of the settlement.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Pam Cosell.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. My question's round, obviously, the ring fencing. The Director of Finance at East Lothian Council spoke about how around three quarters of their budget is wrapped up in directed spend. They are still got all of the policy commitments to deal with, so it doesn't really provide any flexibility. That is despite some formerly ring-fenced budgets being baselined. So my question is around, to what extent is the budget unring-fenced, and what was COSLA's role in this process? And I know, Councillor Katie, you did mention the policy commitments, so can I start with you, please?
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you for your question. I think there absolutely is still a significant amount of our funding that it does go towards directed spend. Your huge portions of our budget does go towards education and also the staffing, you know, our pay elements. So, you know, there's around about 75% of that. And, you know, as well as education, there is obviously the commitments to our IJBs as well, which nobody's going to argue against the importance of that. I think, as I said previously with the convener there, the fiscal framework is continuing that work. And I know that my chief officer, Mirren, has been working very closely with Scottish Government and with officials within that sphere. So that's a continued piece of work. Mirren maybe wants to come in some of the details of that, but certainly there is, you know, COSLA leaders have reaffirmed their commitment to the Verity House Agreement. Nobody's walking away from this new partnership of way of working. That being said, there is disappointment across all leaders that the settlement, you know, as published and at this stage, it does, you know, doesn't give us what we require to deliver the services fully that we want to within and across all our communities. But I'll maybe pass over to Mirren in terms of the specifics.
Yeah, just to kind of give you two examples to kind of illustrate our point. So, part of the funding that was baselined, £522 million for the 1,140, the 1140 hours commitment for ELC. So that money is no longer formally ring-fenced, but we're still delivering it. There's not a suggestion that 1140 hours is being cut. So it's still directed spend, and there is extremely limited flexibility to do anything else. That commitment still has to be met. Another example would be the £333.5 million that was baselined, which has been supporting the real living wage for adult social care staff. There's an additional £230 million being added in this year to get to £12 an hour. You can't stop paying the previous £10.90 if you're going to pay £12. So again, there's no, it's still directed spend. It's directed for a specific purpose, and there's no flexibility to change that. So those are just kind of two examples to illustrate what we mean when we're describing that.
Thank you, Marion. Do you have anything to add to that?
Just maybe another couple of examples. The vast majority of local authority expenditure goes in two areas, education and social work. And the very biggest cost in terms of the education budget is teachers' pay. So of a total of around £13.9 billion in the local government settlement, £3.2 billion is directed to pay for teacher pay. That's effectively direct. We can do little with that in a scenario where we're saying we can't vary the number of teachers that we employ, 54,000 teachers across Scotland. So that huge element of the education budget is essentially directed towards that spend. Another area where there's a high level of direction is around integration joint boards. And every year councils are told you can't reduce the amount of money that's been put into your integration joint board, and in fact you're expected normally to increase that. And that direction is coming out of the overall pot, reducing flexibility to invest in other services. So there are direct policy choices being made by government in terms of the local government settlement, which is reducing flexibility to deliver the other services, the other important services that we deliver for communities.
No, thank you. Katie, I just want to go back to, you mentioned around the fiscal framework. The Verity House Agreement stated that a fiscal framework would be concluded by the end of September 2023. That hasn't obviously happened, and just 4 weeks ago, the Deputy First Minister said already many of the principles we have agreed together are being put into practice, such as improved engagement ahead of the Scottish Budget. Would you agree with this assessment, given COSLA was admittedly blindsided by the decision to freeze council tax, and when can we expect the framework to be completed? Do you want to go for it, Katie, first? Yeah.
No, thank you. So I don't recognise that there was an agreement that it would be completed by September 2023. Certainly there is a commitment to continue on that work. And I think the word within the Verity House agreement was the aspiration for a fiscal framework. So, you know, there's a difference there, but certainly, you know, I would, as said previously, there has been challenges, absolutely. COSLA was very clear that they were not consulted as part of the council tax freeze, and certainly COSLA leaders were very clear and collectively with one voice made that point direct to the First Minister. So, you know, that clearly has gone against the principles, and that has put strains on it. It is a new partnership. It is being tested. However, there has been engagement going forward. We had our first meeting with all group leaders and spokespeople with the cabinet led by the Deputy First Minister. So, you know, that engagement has taken place, the first of those which we agreed would happen twice a year. I know the COSLA President and Vice President has met with First Minister regularly, so that has been taken forward. And I have had meetings with the Deputy First Minister to take these issues forward. Has it been enough? Would I have liked more? Would we have wanted more information prior to the publication of the budget? Absolutely, yes. You know, we need to improve on that. But as I say, we are at the early stages of this. I think, as I said, there was surprises within the budget. One of the lines that we were working on was that there would be no surprises, and that hasn't been the case. That being said, we are fully committed to the sort of three outcomes going forward, which is primarily sustainable public services, of which obviously budget decisions are, you know, are vitally important in that sustainability, but also tackling child poverty and the just transition to net zero, which with a cut to our capital budget is going to have a significant effect going forward as we work towards meeting our net zero ambitions of the future and of the current, I would say.
Thank you, Councillor Katie. Marion?
Yeah,
Yeah, it's just to clarify, it was absolutely the aspiration that we have a fiscal framework for September 23. We underestimated the complexity of genuine things that we need to work through and model in terms of the capacity both within Scottish Government and within COSLA to take that forward. So it is the aspiration to get this completed as soon as we can, but clearly quite a lot of us that are needed to work on the fiscal framework have been subsequently working on the budget, and so I expect that we'll make sort of significant progress over the next time. So,
David, do you want to add anything?
Just to note, I think that everyone agrees that a fiscal framework for local government is a prize worth having, and it's something that we're committed to working towards. As Myrne says, capacity is a challenge, both for local government and the Scottish Government in moving this. Moving this forward, but we're absolutely, you know, committed to working towards a system which gives us increased sustainability, greater transparency, and hopefully more financial flexibility in terms of what we can deliver for the people of Scotland.
Councillor Katie, can I just come back to you? You had said that you had already met with the Scottish Government, and that was a positive meeting to move forward after the council tax freeze. I've been speaking to local authorities. I've spoken to now 24 of them, and I've obviously got their part, how they're feeling. After that meeting, have they felt that they have much more certainty that with this Verity House agreement and the work we're doing in the fiscal framework?
So in terms of council leaders at COSLA, you know, that position hasn't changed. Nobody, not one leader was welcoming of the council tax freeze in terms of what it meant for our budget. So the discussion with Cabinet was an opportunity for us to have an open dialogue to raise these issues. So from that point of view, it was a positive space, because previously we didn't necessarily have that open dialogue space, which absolutely is important. You know, there's really, you know, there's large challenges looming ahead, and it's only when we can have that open dialogue and have that really honest conversation that we can move the narrative forward as such. So, you know, there was an opportunity there to speak with the Cabinet Secretary regarding the issues around education. You know, there was also issues to raise about net zero ambitions. And of course, we did raise the issue of the council tax freeze and how that didn't sit within the Verity House agreement and how, you know, damaging that could have been. However, we reiterated our commitment going forward that we weren't wanting to walk away from that. And as David said there, there's a greater prize to be won within that. And being able to take that holistic overview, being able to work together to see, well, actually, you know, make the case that, you know, it's not necessarily just teacher numbers that are going to improve the outcomes of our young people. And if we want to take forward our net zero ambitions and, you know, reduce our emissions, your local government partners are absolutely key in taking that forward.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Pam. I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for coming along this morning, panel. So if I could start with yourself, David, and I'm happy for others to come in as well there. You described the fiscal framework as a prize worth having, and Councillor Hagman has already touched on the three shared priorities: poverty, transition to net zero and sustainable public services. So my initial question was, to what extent does the 2024-25 budget enable local government to progress to the three shared priorities? But I suppose, really, I'm quite interested in actually how you think that might look in the future when we have the fiscal framework. Does it seem realistic to you that we could have complementary policies from national and local government that focus on those priorities and have you working together to really best meet the needs of people and our communities?
So I think in terms of complementary policies, local government deliver the vast majority of outcomes that the Scottish Government are trying to deliver in terms of public policy across Scotland. We make significant, you know, contributions to those policy objectives in terms of education, social work, transport policy, a whole range of other issues. So there's, and we're working very closely with the Scottish Government around a whole policy agenda in terms of early years and a whole social care and a whole raft of issues. So yes, much of what the Scottish Government and local government are trying to do is entirely complementary, while local government are obviously ensuring that the specific needs of local communities are being met. The extent to which the budget assists with that process, I think, is slightly more debatable. There is signs of increased strain in terms of local government and its financial sustainability, which have not been helped by the reductions that we've seen in terms of the settlement and the pressures that we're trying to manage through things like inflation. The reductions that we've seen to the capital budget in terms of our desire to invest in areas like net zero is not being assisted by restrictions in the funding that we have available. Councils are struggling therefore to deliver against the key priorities like poverty and exclusion in local communities, and having to divert a bigger share of our funding towards those areas, while other areas in terms of quality of life and the assistance that we can provide to communities in a whole range of ways is being reduced. So I'm not convinced that the settlement as it currently stands is necessarily assisting local government to assist with those three policy priority areas, although they remain an absolutely key focus for us.
Happy to hear from yourself, Councillor Hagman. No, Midden.
Do you want me to come first, or Midden? Do you want to go ahead and then I'll come in and capture any other aspects?
To agree with David, I mean, the quite stark and obvious one is net zero and the capital budgets that are available. We do appreciate that the capital budget to Scottish Government has been, difficult choices were needed, but it's clarity on why these particular choices were made, given that there are sort of shared priorities and what that means. And I think it'd be good to see that across the piece in terms of contributing to some of the other ones. I would sort of strongly echo David's point. There is serious concern about the financial sustainability of local authorities, that there is a direct cut to the revenue budget. So that means services will have to be cut to address that. And the knock-on impact that has for our staff and our communities and the services that are provided will be noticeable and will be significant. The LGIU survey that was published just before Christmas indicated that there are serious concerns sort of throughout, senior directors of finance, leaders of councils, chief execs of councils about the impact of budgets, and it has been particularly compounded over the last few years by the rates of inflation that everyone has seen and everyone has been dealing with. And local authorities have attempted to sort of mitigate the impact on communities as much as possible. But all of, the energy bills for all the schools, for all the care, for all of that, all of those have increased significantly as well for the public sector. And that has a compounding effect. So I think I would say I do don't think the budget does kind of allow any significant progress towards the three targets.
To be fair, I think we all understand that, because the Scottish Government is in exactly the same position with hospitals, etc. as well there. So interested to hear from you, Katie, as well. And could you perhaps touch on the things, for example, like the Scottish Child Payment, which has lifted around 90,000 children out of poverty? Does that have a knock-on effect on councils as well? Does that stop some families having to come to councils and look for additional supports there?
Yeah, no, thank you for the question. I mean, clearly with your background, you'll be aware that as councillors, we're trying to make decisions across a whole host of services that we're providing. And, frontline services, I think it's very important that we always keep in mind potentially any unintended consequences, and that's always in the background. So when we're working towards, you know, these ambitions, we're always trying to look at new ways to ensure we can progress those. And, you know, I think it is important to make, you know, I mentioned teachers and the fact that we absolutely want to be committed to, you know, closing that poverty attainment gap, but we will also want to be lifting our families out of poverty. And certainly the Scottish Child Payment is doing that. I'm aware that the Joseph Downtree Foundation was giving evidence to the Finance Committee last week. And certainly I think they provided evidence that, you know, this is a really good policy. And their request is that money that is increased. Now, appreciate that there is not enough funding to go around to meet all these aspirations. But I think, you know, the Scottish Child Payment has proven itself to be of value and it is doing some really fantastic work. At the same time, across councils, you know, we're attempting and we're trying to capture people before they find themselves in difficult situations. And, you know, the budget as it stands is challenging. You know, one of the key aspects that was brought up in numerous forums when cabinet secretaries were hosting roundtable discussions on child poverty, which the First Minister had made a commitment and had taken forward that piece of work. And, you know, one of the points that was brought up repeatedly was that around pay and actually having, you know, sustainable and fairly funded pay for families. And unfortunately, the budget as it stands, there is nothing within that budget that is allocated towards pay. Now, appreciate that our budget lobbying did include a level of inflation, which would have captured, you know, the opportunity to put forward pay increases. And, you know, within that, I absolutely accept that the Scottish Government's budget that they received from Westminster isn't inflation-proofed. So therefore, you know, that makes it even more difficult. But, you know, that issue around going forward with pay awards, you know, we're going to find ourselves in a challenging situation. I think, you know, additionally, the cut to the affordable housing supply programme is going to have significant effect knock on, which is going to, you know, it's going to make it harder to reach those shared ambitions. Though I appreciate, I think my colleague Councillor Maureen Chalmers is going to be coming to give evidence to yourselves next week on that specific issue. So that'll be something that you're able to explore further. But, you know, it is a challenge. But we are committed to those outcomes, and it's how do we navigate our way through. We've not yet had confirmation. It's still uncertain what the implications are going to be around teacher numbers, and that's something that continues to have dialogue. So, you know, we will continue to work with government, with cabinet secretaries on finding a holistic solution to the issues that we're all facing right across the country.
Thank you, Camilla. Thanks very much for that. Now I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Just before I ask my questions, I'll just declare an interest as being a former councillor in West Dunbartonshire up until May 2022. Moving on to my question, obviously we heard last week from the four directors of finance who described the pressures that their councils are facing. We've also had the report from the Local Government Information Unit showing real concern about the future of council finances, also backed up this morning by the Accounts Commission report. What would you like, Cosla, what would you like to see happen from now until March when the budget is finalised to help public services and local government finance become more sustainable? And I'll pop it to yourself, Councillor Hagman, and then obviously over to Ms Kelly. Thanks.
Yeah, so I mean, the simple answer to that is we would like everything in our councils, our key document, to be recognised and to be fully funded. You know, that, however, that's, you know, we appreciate that that's not going to be possible within the current financial climate. However, we absolutely must recognise that the pressures are being faced. And certainly, you know, the budget is only at the stage one just now. It's still got a significant time to go through. I'm happy to share with the committee that I have got a meeting with the Deputy First Minister on Thursday, along with the President and Vice President. So, you know, we are continuing to have dialogue with government, and we will be, you know, working closely together to ensure that, you know, the information is shared properly and actually make that case as to why we do need to see an increase in funding. That being said, I'm realistic. I understand that, you know, there isn't endless amounts of money, and difficult and challenging decisions absolutely must be made. And I guess this is where we go back to that issue around directed spend, about ring fencing. And, you know, there has to be those really difficult conversations. What areas are we going to have to perhaps deprioritise? And if we do that, we have to have it in a grown-up manner, so we don't end up with the finger-pointing of blame, because so often within politics, we end up in this blame culture, and it's somebody's fault, and it's this party's fault, and this individual's decision. Of course, it comes down to individual political choices. But if we're going to find a solution through, we do need to have to almost rise above that and actually have those really difficult conversations and work through these together. Because ultimately, if we don't, we end up, you know, the trust from members of public within our communities is lost, because we're seen to be arguing over different figures and what's going to be working. So, yeah, it's hugely challenging. And I don't think anybody's shying away from that difficult process. But we have to find a way through. We have to find a different way of doing this, which is why that reinforcing and coming back to that fiscal framework and actually progressing that at pace, you know, from my point of view, must come forward. But that's not going to help us in the immediate term right now. But, you know, we remain open. And I know the directors of finance are also meeting regularly to look at ways of how they can prioritise what would be their ask. And COSLA leaders will be meeting at the end of the month, and we will be able to take forward, you know, more information as it becomes apparent and as we have a greater understanding of what the issues are to go get over.
Thanks, Councillor Hagen. I really appreciate your comments there. Ms Kelly, do you want to kind of expand on that, or anything else to
just
add?
ever so slightly. It's what Councillor Hagman outlines is the key bit. We need to be having the honest and open conversation with Scottish Government, with the public, about the difficult choices that need to be made. What do we want our public services to look like? Where do we prioritise this? And where does that mean, if there is not additional funding, where do we have to change what we do and potentially stop what we're doing? And that's the conversation that needs to be had. At the moment, local government is looking at dealing with a £63 million direct cut before dealing with any pay or inflation, to kind of illustrate the challenge that pay has within the local government sector. A 1% pay rise costs £105 million. So any pay rise is over £100 million. So it's a really big, it's not a small issue, it's a big challenge, and it will be difficult conversations, but I think those are the ones that we need to have, and need to have honestly with the public as well, because I think when you, and there have been, I know local authorities have done it locally, and I think there's been some research sort of on a more national basis about, you know, the public appetite, about willingness to pay, willingness to fund public services. And quite often, certainly when local authorities go out and ask, you know, they sort of say, we could put up your council tax by 5% and this is what will happen, or we could put it up by 8% and this is what will happen. And quite, you know, the response is generally, well, we quite want to keep our libraries and our swimming pools and those sorts of things. So if that means paying a bit more, then that's what we need to consider doing. So I think that's the space that we need to get to, kind of collectively as a nation. So,
no, absolutely. We heard similar views last week. Moving on to my next question, obviously the Verity House Agreement commits to the multi-year budget certainty where possible. However, the Scottish Government budget only includes the 1 year, and we heard some views last week from finance officers on this too. It does cause, I believe, the Scottish Government could and should have provided indicative multi-year settlements in its budget this year. And what impact does a single-year budget have on local government and third sector partners? I'll pop it to yourself, Ms Kelly, first.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as was expressed by Director of Finance, there can be a mixed view, and there's a risk of where multi-year budget settlements are do not provide the level of certainty and are not based on the certainty, then that introduces additional risks within that. So we do appreciate that it can be challenging to do that, but local authorities do set their own medium-term strategies. So there is, you know, there is a bit about surely there's more that can be done, even if where it's not possible due to Scottish Government itself not having the certainty that they feel they can't set sort of formal multi-year budgets. There was a second impact on local government and third sector. So the impact on local government is that it's less efficient. It means that you can't properly plan forward what you're intending to do. It makes any kind of sort of change, you know, medium or long term change difficult. It can lead to quite a lot of inefficiencies, particularly around staff retention, all of those issues. And this is absolutely a big issue for the third sector, because it prevents local government from being able to provide much certainty to the third sector partners who they work with, either that, you know, grants or commissioning might be able to continue in the way that they are. I'm aware that there are local authorities that, where they can, also do provide multi-year grants or commission services with third sector partners, but the ability to do that is limited, and the local authority is then taking on all of the risk that that the budget comes through and it turns out that there's a £63 million cut to it. So it's...
Yeah, aware of that too. Yeah. Councillor Hagman, do you want to add anything?
No, not really. I mean, Meriden's answer there is quite comprehensive. I think it does come down to workforce planning, both for local authorities and our third sector. I know certainly within my own local authority in Dumfries and Galloway, we have committed to, you know, commissioned services beyond a year. But then that does fall to the local council to take that forward. So yeah, I mean, it's absolutely vital that we look at our workforce planning, but without that uncertainty. But, you know, I think it's accepted that, you know, Scottish Government doesn't get a multi-year funding settlement itself, so, you know, that creates that level of challenge going forward.
Thanks for that. Give you that speech.
Thanks very much, Marie. Actually, a question that comes up for me, and I'm not necessarily expecting anyone to have the answer to this, but it is kind of, what is the root of this single year approach? Because obviously it's coming from the UK government, that the Scottish government gets the single year funding, and then that happened, then a knock on effect is for local authorities. But I wonder historically where that came from, because it's astounding that pretty much the whole of Scotland is run on a one year budget. I mean, how can you really run a country in that way? And I wonder if you've got any thoughts or understanding of that.
It emerges from cash budgeting at central government level and an annualisation around the historically the UK and subsequently the Scottish Government budget. We have previously had a scenario where we have received indicative multi-year settlements, and that's been hugely helpful in terms of planning and planning long-term transformational change, which is absolutely the key to this. The bottom line on it is that council spending 4 or 5 months of the year you know, putting together a budget is an inherently inefficient process, and if we could get more certainty in terms of our financial planning, recognising that things may change, that would be hugely helpful to us.
Katie, did you want to come in on this?
No, I think David has covered it. I think, I could make all sorts of comments about the political nature of that one, but I'll maybe not at this point. But no, I mean, ultimately, we want to be working in the most efficient way, and this is not the most efficient way.
Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone on the panel. I'd like to focus in on the council tax freeze issue with yourself, Councillor Hagman. As you know, the offer on the table is £144 million, and that we think that represents about 5%. The big question is, and everybody says it's not enough, what is enough? Has COSLA got a settled view on what the figure should be? The Minister will be coming in a wee while to join us in part two of this committee session, so unless you've told him directly yourself what is enough, what would you say to this committee just now about what COSLA's view is on that?
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you for that. So, yeah, I mean, I absolutely recognise that the £144 million has been framed as a 5% council tax increase. However, I think if we go back to maybe the start of the questions in terms of looking at the core budget, when we take into account the core budget and the drop in revenue on that one, it translates to approximately a 2.8% council tax increase. Now, again, we're perhaps comparing apples to oranges, or perhaps apples to pizzas at this point. You know, they are very, very different, and it is a real challenge. Ultimately, you know, I recognise that, you know, that we're in a cost of living crisis, and, you know, as a government, the government is looking to support, you know, hardworking families who are paying council tax going forward. I recognise that this was a political decision going forward. However, you know, if we go back to the point that Mirren had just made there, you know, when we're looking at cuts to our services, there are times where communities don't mind paying that little bit extra to make sure that their services are safeguarded. And certainly from our Councils Are Key document, we were very clear that, you know, there was a range of council tax figures used within that. And certainly, you know, one local authority was planning on a council tax increase of up to 10%. I think if the core budget hadn't been cut, it would be a different situation if we were looking at that 5% funding. But it will be different across local authority areas, and we're still looking at how that 5% potentially is going to be distributed, because that information hasn't been settled upon as yet. So that's an ongoing dialogue right now within the council tax funding of £144 million.
Okay, thanks for that. You said people would be happy to accept a little bit extra. What is that? Is it the 2.8% you mentioned there? Is it 5% that the Scottish Government think it is? Is it 8% that one of the contributors last week thought it could be? We never quite pin this down to what an acceptable little bit extra figure actually is. Does COSLA have a view from your member authorities about what they consider that figure should be?
So within the budget lobbying document, we did include the full council tax freeze for £300 million. So, you know, we included that as part of our budget lobbying. So, you know, we asked for £300 million and we got £144 million. So that did lead to about 10% to include and capture a range of opinions across local councils. I think the real difficulty with this one is, you know, councillors don't want to ever put up council tax. We absolutely appreciate that it is a tax. And, you know, there's a sort of a ongoing dialogue of which I co-chair with the Minister about looking at council tax reform. And that's a really positive space. That's something that we are progressing. And, you know, that's almost a separate dialogue of empowering local authorities and, you know, the increase on second homes. And, you know, there is a real positivity coming out of that space. But if we return to where we are right now, you know, we had asked for that 10% essentially to cover a whole host of bases. But ultimately, until we know what the settlement is, you know, the council tax is one of these questions that will, what cuts are we able to make? What is palatable? What is not? How do you balance putting up the council tax, reference what you may need to have to cut? And, you know, I think it's fair to say that council administrations, they rise and fall on council tax decisions. When you speak to your constituents and it's coming up the budget, one of the first questions people ask is, what's happening with the council tax this year? But until we know the final settlement figures, it's quite hard sometimes to judge where your local authority is going to pitch that council tax increase or not.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Katie. I'll move on and ask you perhaps about the workforce challenges issue that's been featured at the committee during the course of this. We know there are workforce shortages particularly, but there's also workforce challenges, which is a different thing. I think we alluded to that earlier there when we were talking about directed spend and the lack of flexibility. What kind of discussion is COSLA having with the Scottish Government about these issues, the workforce issues? And am I interpreting what your colleague said earlier about flexibility when it comes to directed spend? Does that include workforce issues and workforce numbers?
It absolutely does. And I think, you know, it was referenced the £3.2 billion that we spend that goes on the payroll for teachers. So, you know, that's a significant spend within that area. But we also need to have that flexibility and that understanding that, you know, in order to have good education, absolutely, we need good teaching staff and we need teachers within the classroom. But we also need a whole host of support, you know, as part of that holistic viewpoint. So whether that is, you know, classroom assistance or, you know, the delivery of free school meals, that's a huge issue. And it's a real positive and will bring positive outcomes to our young people. You can't learn if you're hungry. And, you know, I think the Scottish Government's commitment to the delivery of free school meals is absolutely admirable. And we need to find a way to progress some of these. But in terms of the workforce challenges, you know, there is, I think there's that recognition that each local authority is so very, very different. And what is a challenge in one area is not necessarily reflected in another. You know, I think it's fair to say that we are looking at ways to be innovative, and we have got a special interest group in COSLA that is directly looking at ways of transforming. And, you know, it's an innovation space. It's allowing that space to have dialogue to say, well, where can we do things differently? How can we be more efficient? How can we work collaboratively? So we have got that working group space that is ongoing. However, I think it's also fair to say that across local government, we've been doing this for a number of years, and we're not finding our way through it, which is why, I guess, returning to the Verity House Agreement, where we're focusing on these three outcomes and how we take that forward, has to be key. And we have to be fully committed. And again, it's about having those really difficult conversations of saying sometimes we're not going to be able to deliver that and we don't end up in that blame game.
Thank you for that, Councillor Hagman. Any comments on that issue in workforce from David or Mirren?
Well, I guess it's just to kind of highlight around 70% of local government spend is on staffing. So any any budgetary decision has necessarily has to consider the workforce. But the workforce we have are the vast, vast majority are frontline, and they're delivering these key services. So cutting the workforce means effectively cutting these services. That there are many spaces where there's limited opportunity for efficiencies sort of in how some things are delivered, but there are opportunities in other spaces. But I would, so the work, the size of the workforce in local government is now sort of recovered back to where it was in around 2011. But that ignores quite a significant increase in responsibility. The 1140 hours, the free school meal provision, the requirements to maintain teacher numbers, etc., the improvements on PTR, pupil-teacher ratio. So there's the workforce is doing a lot, but every change we make necessarily has to consider the workforce implications, and there are huge challenges in terms of recruitment and retention. And I think you heard some really good examples last week from Director of Finance of the challenges that they face kind of locally in councils. And I think the point is it's not just remote and rural areas, but they have unique and added challenges. It is also, the Director of Finance for Glasgow is saying that the real difficulty they have in recruiting sort of key professionals that keep everything going. So.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose all I would add is, I mean, there's been 260,000 people working in the local government workforce in 2023, and councils really are a very, very complicated businesses, and they require professional people to run them from a variety of different professional backgrounds, surveyors, lawyers, planners, engineers, clerks of works, all these kinds of, and we're increasingly struggling to recruit people to these professional disciplines in local government. One of the reasons for that is because there's not the money to basically employ the numbers of people that we would wish to see in a number of these areas. We've prioritised education and social work quite correctly over the years, but that's meant that councils have had to make reductions in other central services, and we're increasingly struggling to get the breadth and quality of people we need to run Scotland's councils effectively. And that's a major challenge for us in terms of workforce planning. When you look at the age demographic around the workforce, bringing people into local government and making young people see that as an attractive career where they can develop and flourish is a real challenge. And sitting at the heart of that is resource and what we can afford to do with regard to our workforce.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm sure that'll be an important part of your discussions, your ongoing discussions with the Minister. I'm absolutely certain about that because it crops up time and time again. My third question is really about capital budgets, and start with you again, if I can, Councillor Hagman. We know there's been a reduction to Scotland's capital budget, but as one of the provisions that the Scottish Government has made is to allow a transfer of £120 million from capital to revenue. It's just to ask you your view of that. On the one hand, it will help the revenue budget, but on the other hand, it clearly has an impact on the capital budget. And I'm thinking particularly about issues like RAC and how we make progress towards net zero within other various council estates that we have. Could you give us your view, Councillor Hagman, about what you think about that and whether that's the right measure to do or whether we need to do more or differently?
Yeah, no, thank you. I think, in terms of the figures there, I'll maybe pass over to Mirren because, the transfer of funding, I think, was to do with last year and the pay, and that's it's maybe a more technical point. But on the wider issue of cuts to our capital budget, yeah, absolutely. The issue of that is ongoing, and certainly we are working closely with Scottish Government on finding solutions going forward. Clearly the issues of RAC within schools was highly publicised within the media, but RAC isn't just in schools, it's across our community centres, and certainly Minister Shirley-Ann Somerville has been in touch with myself and written to keep in touch and to continue that dialogue on how we should progress that. I think there's also issues, as you say, you mentioned about the our ambitions to net zero, and it's about 82% of all emissions are within the scope and influence of local government decisions. So, you know, clearly that's going to have a significant effect. There has been cuts made to the regeneration capital grant funding, of which, you know, really allows, well, exactly what it says in the tin, that regeneration of some of our derelict buildings, of some of the projects taken forward, you know, and I've seen some hugely positive projects progress and be completed with the assistance of that Scottish Government funding. And obviously there's the Derelict Land Improvement Programme, which again is taking forward some really ambitious targets, but with cuts to that funding as well, it is going to have a knock-on effect. I think, what was the other point you made there about the capital? I'll maybe pass over to Miriam in terms of the actual details on that one, though. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, just to pick up the point about the 120.6 million, that was put into the local government settlement as capital to support the 22-23 pay deal. That was by agreement with local government, where local government had identified areas where we could effectively release revenue by having the capital funding. So where local government was maybe using revenue to support a capital project, instead they were then able to take the capital money and release the revenue to support the pay. What we'd said at that point, though, was we can only sustain that for 2 years, and it must come in as revenue funding from this year onwards. So that was a known and sort of expected in terms of what we were expecting as a base. However, there is a cut of 37.1 million to our core capital grant. There's then additional cuts to our specific capital grants, and even more cuts to other areas such as the regeneration capital grant funding that Councillor Hagman mentioned, and really noticeably the affordable housing supply programme. So all of those will have a huge impact on the capital plans that had been made and actually already significantly revised due to inflation, but also communities in the local economy. The impact of that huge cut to the affordable housing supply programme will be noticed, both for those, you know, homelessness, but also the impact on the economy for that. But it does go back to your point. The core capital grant that we have is used to invest and maintain some key and useful community assets. That cut makes it incredibly more difficult for local authorities to be able to deal with issues such as RAC or any other maintenance issue that sort of exists. And it just makes it that much harder for everyone.
And as you were talking there, I was trying to double check some of the figures that I mentioned there, and in the briefing we have from our SPICE colleagues, it does show an additional 120.6 million being switched from capital to revenue for the 24-25 budget. So that's quite clear in the figures. I don't know what we could clarify that, but that's what it says here. So that measure last year is being repeated for the year coming, the same capital to revenue switch.
So it's been, yeah, so instead of receiving it as capital this year, it has been switched to revenue.
And it's being done next year.
It's it was capital last year, yeah. or this 23-24, and yeah, is coming in as revenue in 24-25.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks very much for your responses to all those questions. I appreciate it. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs with the last few questions.
Thank you. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Firstly, with regards to Causeley's views around the hopes for the European Charter of Local Self-Government Bill, which we're expecting to come back to Parliament for reconsideration stage, and just your views on how you think that can help, especially around the financial situation we've discussed this morning. Katie, I don't know if you want to come in first on that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it was a question that was raised at our leadership sounding board on Friday of where are we? So because the leaders are very keen that this progresses, and certainly, you know, there are huge advantages of getting this bill enacted, and about raising the parity between Scottish and local government. I think it's absolutely one of our long-term objectives that this progresses, and it is one of the key elements that has been mentioned as part of the Verity House Agreement. So I think it does, you know, it strengthens the status and standing of Scottish local government, which obviously, from a COSLA point of view, we've got that ambition going forward. And, you know, within that, there is also, or sort of aside to that, you know, there's a desire to have those general powers of competency for local government to empower us going forward as well. However, you know, again, we have to be really mindful around the language and the framework, the wider framework we're working within. Where other countries across Europe maybe have this, it's not necessarily always in the gift of Scottish government to pass those powers to Scottish local authorities, because the Scottish government don't have those powers from Westminster. So we're working in a slightly different landscape and framework to perhaps, you know, other European countries across Europe. But it is absolutely an ambition, and one that we are keen to progress, and one that was, as I say, pressed last week, and the question raised of where are we, and, you know, can we get this progress at pace? I think Meryn maybe wants to come in possibly with some further comments, though, in terms of the opportunities.
I think a key point is that establishing, you know, that right to local self-governance in legislation is value. And I think one of the areas that we would see that provides sort of benefits quite apart, you know, within that, the parity of a seam space, is ensuring that where there are any changes that might affect local government, that there's a stronger requirement to ensure that we are part and party of that discussion and development at the outset, rather than sometimes brought in as things have already been developed. I think one of the other areas that has been sort of flagged this year from it is the impact that we would expect the EU Charter for local self-governance to have on decisions around, for instance, council tax freeze.
That's helpful. Thank you. We've touched upon reserves already this morning, but I wanted to ask what COSLA's view is around the use of reserves by councils to cover some of their funding gaps they face. Again, some of the conversations we've had around how big reserves are, how depleted they are over the past few weeks have also been part of our deliberations. But just wondered what COSLA's view is and advice being given to councils as well.
If I maybe come in with maybe some of the general points, and then Meryn can fill in with the level of detail. But certainly, you know, across our councils, all councils are holding varying levels of reserves. I think it's really important that we bear in mind that reserves are just one-off pots of funding. So therefore, you know, it's not possible to use one-off funding for recurring costs. It wouldn't be seen as good governance or good practice going forward. We've also got the situation that some of our reserves are used for underwriting some really ambitious projects going forward. You know, there's funding that comes in from a whole load of streams, and we, you know, ultimately, the councils are sometimes faced with having to underwrite those themselves. You know, reserves are there for those emergency situations. And I think it was referenced earlier about the use of reserves in dealing with environmental and storm damage. I know, for example, Angus was particularly struck at the tail end of last year and had to rely heavily on their reserves to combat that. So, you know, we have to ensure that our reserves are there and utilised correctly. I mean, ultimately, yes, reserves are there for that rainy day. And, you know, I think it's fair to say it is pouring quite heavily at the moment, but, you know, the rain could continue for a long term. So, you know, we have to be mindful of how those are utilised. Yes, we acknowledge that they are there, but ultimately the majority of those reserves are earmarked and there for good reason. And once they've gone, they've gone. And, you know, I think there has been stark warnings from, you know, south of the border across England, where some local authorities are facing those issues of bankruptcy. They don't have those reserves to see them through. We're not in that situation in Scotland right now, but there are some local authorities that are exceedingly concerned and worried for the future. So we do have to be really mindful of how those are spent. But in terms of specific further clarity, I'll maybe bring Mary in if I may.
I think the key point is there is an increasing number of councils that are unfortunately having to rely on reserves to balance their budget, and that isn't sustainable, and that is of significant concern. And I think that's sort of echoed by the Accounts Commission report today as well. I think you might want to hear from David on this one from a specific examples.
Well, I suppose what I would say on reserves is reserves, the maintenance of reserves is a fundamental part of good financial planning, and you would expect businesses as large and as complex as local authorities faced with the range of risks that we have to run an appropriate level of reserves. The local government benchmarking framework set out for 21-22 showed you that the majority of councils, the average level of reserves is around 3.5% of net revenue expenditure, and faced with the range of uncertainty that we have in terms of potential storm damage or winter weather conditions or a whole host of other issues that we're seeking to manage, that doesn't seem to be unreasonable. The key point about reserves, of course, is that they can only be used once, and they need to be topped up. And the other thing that I think people should remember is that these reserves are not necessarily cash backed. There's not necessarily an account you can go to and say, I'm going to withdraw my reserves now. You need to go out and actually borrow that money in order to replenish your reserves. So they're a fundamental part of good financial management, but they're not. There's not necessarily a big pot of bailout money sitting there that we can draw on. They're very much there for an emergency situation. To put that into context, in my authority, we maintain a winter reserve. A large dump of snow will cost us £1 to £2 million to deal with that over a week. And if you look at the 3.5% in the context of, you know, operating expenditure, that's probably equivalent to two weeks operating expenditure for the majority of councils.
Yeah. There's maybe more questions around that. We could ask Scottish Government for those councils which have had to use their reserves and are looking at them. But I also wanted to ask a question with regards to national policies, which are announced requiring local authorities to help assist in their delivery, and to what extent COSLR ensure that these policies which aren't delivered and asked to be delivered by local authorities are then appropriately funded, and going forward, how they can be properly maintained with inflation and potentially additional demands which might emerge. So just wondered what sort of framework currently exists, what should maybe be coming out with Verity House, and what that looks like and what needs to change. So maybe bring you in, Katie, and if anyone else wants to add.
Yeah, so I mean, clearly there is going to be political choices, national policies coming forward, and certainly COSLA is very, very clear that we must have early dialogue of any of those, and you know, where local government is the delivery partner, that we work collaboratively together on that one. They absolutely must be fully funded, and I think importantly, not just fully funded for that first year, but then baselined going forward. However, you know, we're very clear that we need to move away from that direct to spend and that ring fencing. And that's where, you know, ultimately it comes down to trust. So if that funding is going into the local government budget, then we've made a commitment to deliver some of these initiatives, then, you know, the trust comes down that local government will do that. You know, I think it's a sticky situation because, you know, you have that ring fence money, that directed spend, which has, you know, we've seen an increase going forward. And I think that was one of the key drivers within the Verity House agreement, is we move away from that model, because there has to be that level of trust. You know, councillors are the closest to our communities insofar that, you know, we're right there on the front line within the communities. Our councils sit there, you know, we understand sometimes what the communities are maybe needing more than, you know, essentially ministers at some point, with all respect within that sphere. You know, we have to base our decisions on the evidence and what our outcomes are going to be. So again, you know, there's national policies that come forward which will help towards those agreed priorities. And again, that's where that real honest dialogue of, if there is a new policy coming forward that doesn't necessarily sit within those agreed outcomes, perhaps, you know, local government has to say, no, we're not able to deliver that going forward because these are our priorities. This is what we've agreed. Now, that's not been tested as yet. You know, we are still, as I say, early stages of the Verity House agreement, but it is about that level of bravery and actually doing things differently. I think, again, I may have mentioned this in previous sessions. You know, I'm now 18 months into this role. I don't want to be sitting here in 4 years' time going, well, that was our ambition. You know, it's not happened. So I would really hope that, you know, if I'm invited to give evidence this time next year, I'm able to maybe demonstrate and give some real key examples of where we have deprioritised some of the commitments made. And it's not because we don't want to make them. It's just the real financial constraints that both local government and Scottish government are facing due to the financial uncertainties.
That's helpful, thank you. And just finally, with this period of change which we are going to go through, is it also now time, do you think, to look at and review the funding formula for councils? I represent Edinburgh. Edinburgh receives the lowest share per head of population, but has some of the largest challenges in the whole of the country around homelessness, children in temporary accommodation, and just the national events which also take place here in the capital and the costs that arises with. So just wondered what Cosla's thinking was around that, because when I've put this to the Scottish Government, they're happy to take that forward, but would want Cosla's suggestion that they want that to take place.
So in terms of the funding, I mean, obviously it does come down to quantum. How much have we got going forward? But, you know, how that's distributed and any formulas going forward is something that is being looked at as part of a Verity House agreement and the fiscal framework, our aspiration. So if we have an agreed framework, but I think we have to be mindful, again, of those unintended consequences. And there are going to be some local authorities that are perceived winners and some that are not, depending on what options. So it's a very complex landscape. And I think, you know, we have to balance a whole host of things. So, for example, I think, you know, East Lothian and Mid Lothian as rapidly increasing populations with growth is a real issue. But, you know, similarly across Dumfries and Galloway, where I am, and across the Highlands, you've got areas of depopulation but you still have to provide those statutory services. You know, the issues of roads maintenance. I mean, I think my local authority has, I think, the second largest level of road network, and how do we maintain that, and how do all these formulas work in? It is really, really complicated, and I'm not going to sit here and say that I understand every single aspect of it, because, you know, that's why we have directors of finance. That's why I have, you know, Meryn, who is living and breathing this stuff as chief financial officer for COSLA. So perhaps at this point, it's maybe best for me to pass over to her. But yeah, it's not an easy one. And I know that, again, we've got a working group looking at fiscal framework and how those formulas, different options, how they could be, and we're still working through modelling of that as well with Scottish Government to ensure a really good outcome.
I guess to kind of say, fundamentally, the issue is the size of the cake that we are given rather than the size of individual slices that local authorities receive. If the cake was big enough, you wouldn't have the struggle that you do. And I guess the experience that you hear from locally, from, you know, from your councils who are raising the challenges that they have, that illustrates what we have been saying for the last sort of 10 years and more, that there have been real terms cuts to the local government settlement. This is why it's so difficult for councils to deliver the services that they are required to do and wish to do.
Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. And that's been a very useful session. We've now come to the end of it. You'll be glad to know. Very helpful to hear your perspectives from COSLA. Oh, sorry, Stephanie, you want to come in with a brief supplementary?
No, just very quickly to declare an interest.
Okay.
That I forgot about earlier on. Up until 2022, I was a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And that demonstrates why you've got such good questions, because you've got the previous experience at the local authority level. So, yes, so thanks so much. And I just want to note that there are quite a lot of food metaphors here. So we had a cake and apples this morning while we've been busy with all of these numbers. So thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much.
Pizza, yes, I forgot about that one. Okay. And I now briefly suspend this meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. On our second panel today, we are joined by Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister for Local Government Empowerment and Planning with the Scottish Government. And Mr. Fitzpatrick is joined by Ian Storey, who's the Head of Local Government Finance, and David Cowan, who's the Head of Regeneration and Place at the Scottish Government. And I welcome Minister Ian and David to the meeting, and I'd like to begin by inviting Mr. Fitzpatrick to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and Happy New Year to all members. I want to thank the committee for inviting me to participate in the session today. Particularly grateful that in inviting me, the committee is providing an opportunity to discuss how important our relationship with local government colleagues is in relation to fiscal matters and how the Scottish Government has been working to ensure local government views are included within the broader priorities of government as part of the budget. In line with Verity House Agreement principles, this year has marked the beginning of a more meaningful pre-budget engagement process between local and national government, something that I was pleased to see recognised by local government heads of finance during their session with committee last Tuesday, and I heard Councillor Hagman reference that too in her evidence. I'd also like to take this opportunity to highlight that pre-budget engagement with local government has largely mirrored discussions undertaken with Cabinet Secretaries for their respective portfolio interests too. However, as with Cabinet Secretaries, in the face of a deeply challenging financial situation following the UK Government's autumn statement, inevitably the budget wasn't able to fully meet all of local government's asks. Whilst we appreciate local government will have hoped for a more favourable settlement, we continue to do all that we can to mitigate over a decade of UK government underinvestment in public services. Despite the financial challenges faced, we delivered record funding of over £13.9 billion and made available a further £144 million to support reaching agreement with councils to freeze council tax in 24-25. Critically, in the most difficult budget since devolution, we've prioritised local government and the local government settlement's share of the discretionary budget has increased, and the analysis to support that has been placed in SPICE. In the first budget since the signing of the Verity House Agreement, we've already baselined almost £1 billion of funding across health, education, justice, net zero and social justice prior to agreement on an assurance and accountability framework. That's a significant step for ministers, and we hope it demonstrates both our commitment to the principles of the partnership agreement as well as our willingness to place trust in local government to make more decisions locally that enable better outcomes for communities across Scotland. In the last year, we've worked in partnership with local government to agree greater flexibilities, including on the visitor levy and increased discretionary powers over tax treatment of secondary and empty homes. And that could raise an estimated £35 million for local authorities should they decide to use those powers. We'll also continue to work with COSLA to empower councils through a new fiscal framework with an initial joint progress report published on the 14th of December. The Scottish Government has also committed to empowering local government through increasing discretion to determine and set fees and charges locally. In the coming year, we will include joint work on building warrants and planning fees. Although inflation is slowly falling, the damage caused by the UK Government's economic agenda of austerity and Brexit have hurt everyone, but particularly our most vulnerable households. So we believe that at a time when rising prices are putting significant strain on household finances, a council tax freeze will give some certainty to households over the next year. By funding a freeze, we've helped councils maintain their services while ensuring that households are protected from increasing budgets. I know that local authorities share in our desire to help people across Scotland during these difficult times, and the Scottish Government is hopeful that councils will be able to support this policy initiative locally. I want to assure the committee that we'll continue to work with COSLA to conclude the new deal with local government and provide greater flexibility to councils in future years once the necessary assurance and accountability arrangements are in place. And I believe this will enable local government to better tackle local challenges in ways that work for them, achieving our three shared priorities of tackling poverty, transforming the economy through a just transition to net zero, and delivering sustainable, person-centred public services. As has often been said now by both ministers and local government, this is the beginning of a journey, and as with the building of any new relationships, there will be challenges and missteps along the way. However, if we can successfully achieve the goals of Verity House Agreement, that can only be to the benefit of everyone that we jointly serve. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I'd be interested, you mentioned the Verity House Agreement, which is our new deal with local government, and the three shared priorities there at the end of your opening statement. And I'd be interested to understand from your perspective, from the Scottish Government's perspective, how the 2024 to 25 budget and specifically the local government settlement will help local authorities work towards those priorities that you outlined.
So in line with the Verity House principles this year, has seen a significant increase in meaningful pre-budget engagement with local government, equivalent to the process followed to ensure that Cabinet Secretaries' portfolios, portfolio priorities and the three shared priorities were factored into the budget consideration. So we did that up front and prior, and actually a lot of that work was prior to the autumn statement, which clearly was a surprise and was actually a shock to the Scottish Public Service when that statement was made. The budget invests in the Verity House Agreement by baselining almost £1 billion of funding across health, education, justice, net zero, social justice. And it's crucial to make the point that baselining, which provides greater flexibility, has been provided in advance of the agreement and assurance accountability framework, which has to go alongside the fiscal framework that we're also working on. And we'll continue to work with local government to develop the necessary assurances and accountability arrangements as we go further, because that's what will allow us to provide more flexibility to make sure that the priorities of the Scottish Government, the priorities of this Parliament, are achieved alongside the priorities of local government and the three shared priorities of the Verity House. But to be clear, for this budget, the most difficult budget since devolution, we have prioritised local government with a higher share of our discretionary budget.
OK, thanks. We're going to get into some of those details now, and I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camino. Good morning, Minister. I just wanted to talk about, you know, presentation of the budget figures, how we compare like with like with previous years, you know, to allow the committee and Parliament to scrutinise those figures. Now, government have talked about a 5% increase in this year's budget compared to previous year's budget. COSLA and local authorities have said that a better interpretation would be to compare the money that local authorities received in its entirety for this financial year with the coming financial year, and their interpretation of that is that analysis would compute to a 0.2% reduction in real terms. I just wonder, why is it the government choose, you know, compare budget with budget rather than considering the in-year additions that government have made to support, you know, teacher pay and core pay?
So the short answer is because the Parliament tells us we have to. And the agreement between the Scottish Government and the Finance Committee is absolutely clear that we have to compare like with like. So the pre-budget compared to the pre-budget, it would be appropriate to obviously compare the outturn to the outturn. And it's comparing apples and apples. So we've invested record funding in local government, £14 billion to local authorities, including the council tax fee. And if you compare budget to budget, as required, that represents an increase of £795.7 million, equivalent to a 6% cash terms increase, 4.3% in real terms. Looking at the resource budget, that's increased by £840.3 million since 2023-24, 6.8% cash terms, 5.0% in real terms. But again, just to go back to confirm that the way we've presented the figures comparing budget to budget is as prescribed by the Parliament in our agreement with the Finance Committee.
Okay, take that on board. And when it comes to the presentation of figures, we had Directors of Finance in front of us last week. I think it was Director of Finance from Argyll and Bute almost talked about the presentation of figures being alternative realities. And I just wonder whether there'd be any discussion with the Parliament and the Finance Committee when it comes to the development of the fiscal framework with COSLA to come to, you know, a figure that is universally commonly accepted as the reality facing local government that would allow essentially both sides when it comes to this annual fight over figures to come to an agreed position.
I think so, and I think that's what we're all hoping the fiscal framework will help us do. And as I think we heard from COSLA, that has proved to be more complex than perhaps some people at first thought. But it's important. It's important we get that right. So we're doing the work, COSLA and the Scottish Government, working in good faith to take that forward. I think once the fiscal framework is concluded, I wouldn't be surprised if the Finance Committee took an interest in that, but it may be more for this committee to look at that once we get to that point. Obviously, COSLA have articulated where they got to their figures. That does not align with the Finance Committee's and the Parliament's view of what is comparing like with like and that clear clarity. Ian.
Can I just come in on that point, excuse me? I think the important distinction is that this is about budget scrutiny and the issue that COSLA raises about spending power rather than about budgets. And I do have a recollection, I can't quite remember the financial year, but somewhere about 2016-17, maybe 2017-18, in agreement with the Finance Committee, we did actually publish the budget-to-budget as well as autumn budget revision to budget, which would start to stray into that territory, in the sense that the budget is not a static position. The budget is a constantly evolving position, and the issue you have to pursue the COSLA ask of the latest stated position, you have to do the same for every other portfolio and every other directorate in Scottish Government, because there was no new funding went into the Scottish budget at the start, so it had to be redistributed from within the budget. And as soon as you start to get into that position of departing from budget to budget, the comparisons across the entire budget change constantly, and at the time it was widely agreed by everybody that that did not work as a comparison, and we've never done it since. But again, that was in partnership with the Finance Committee, and I'm sure we could find the financial year. I just can't remember which year it was right this minute.
Okay, thanks for that clarity. The other issue we have spoken about previously when it comes to presentation of figures is that the government say over the period from 2013-14 that local authority finance has increased by 2.6%. That is an entirely accurate presentation of the figures. Local authorities' contention is that between 2013-14 to now, they do far, far more, and that's obvious. You know, looking at social care contributions, 1140, free school meals, there is a whole range that they do, which is over and above what they did in 2013-14. How can we as a committee get to an analysis of essentially what is the baseline of local government funding, stripping out those extra commitments to try and get an understanding and appreciation of what has happened to core local government budgets over that period? I think it was Director of Finance at Glasgow talked about, you know, working 20 hours a week for £40,000, I think, and then expected to work for 40 hours a week for maybe £41,000. Now, that represents an increase in pay, but doesn't take into account the huge increase in working. So, Minister, what's your take on that and how we analyse core government funding without the extra things that are significant, national priorities as well, something we agree with, how we get that a deeper understanding and analysis of what's happened to local government finance?
So I think that point being made by local government is an absolute reasonable point. And if we just take a step back, and in the aftermath of the Smith Commission, there are significant additional responsibilities across a range of public services in Scotland that need to be funded from our devolved budget. On top of that, we've also have significant costs of a range of mitigations that this Parliament considers are necessary to protect communities across Scotland from the worst ravages of Westminster. It's also worth noting that in a lot of these areas there is shared responsibility, and we need to balance our available budget to get the best outcome. So, for example, the £457.3 million, almost half a billion pounds that is budgeted for the Scottish Child Payment, is removing thousands of children from poverty and is working in synergy with anti-poverty actions being taken by many local authorities. So we need to look at the budget in the whole. We need to know that we're all doing more. I think if anyone hears from me or any other government minister a suggestion that this is a budget of easy decisions, it's not. There's been difficult decisions in this budget for the Scottish Government, and there will be difficult decisions for local authority leaders in setting their budgets as well. We all want to do the best for our communities with the limited resources we have.
But does the government have an analysis or an interpretation? I asked Directors of Finance last week to get an understanding of, you know, core local government services and how the finances, the financial settlements over the years from 2013-14 have contributed towards the services that aren't ring-fenced or aren't mandatory service. What has the impact been on that core budget? I just wonder if government have done any analysis of what the core government's local government spend is.
I'll ask Ian to come in, but in general terms, I would suggest that that's exactly the kind of analysis we need to get away from. Because that's looking at the inputs, and actually that doesn't help. We're doing things differently. We're working across local authorities. There's some amazing innovation in terms of the way things are happening, and sometimes a piece of work can help many of the outcomes. We need to look at outcomes, and that's what I'm hoping that the fiscal framework with an accountability and assurance framework sitting alongside it gets us to that point where across government, across local government, and the wider public services, we can really focus on what is making a difference for communities across Scotland. The idea of looking at the way we did stuff 10 years ago when we don't do any of it the same, I don't think it's a real comparison, but maybe Ian, do you want to add a little?
I think you can point to some of the flagship expansions, like the free school meals in the early years, but I think you'd have to then look at other things that have fallen away as well. I remember back in 2013 was probably class size commitments and things. I think the nature of that analysis, I would completely agree with the Minister that we've kind of moved away from those input style measures and we're increasingly trying to move away from them. But the short answer to your question is that I don't think such analysis does exist, and would be intrigued to see what Directors of Finance would come up with.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. My question is kind of moving on from Mark's question, the fact that, you know, councils are providing more new and improved services, for example, like mentioned, free school lunches, early childhood education and certain social care obligations, for instance, have outpaced the funding supplied by the Scottish Government. So my question is around the kind of teacher numbers, Minister, that do you think that local governments must retain teacher numbers even in places where enrolment is declining? And it's very promising to hear from you today that you've said that you're moving away from input measures and moving more to outcomes. After speaking to around about 24 authorities, they've very much welcomed that sort of, language, outcomes, especially with teacher numbers, because where teacher numbers are declining and they still have to basically deliver on what the Scottish Government proposed and put forward, but they are feeling that teachers are important, but also innovation is important and teaching in different ways. So there's a kind of, many things surround teaching, so it's not just about teacher numbers and the declining. So what's your view on that?
So I think in terms of that specific area, I think some of the points are absolutely right. I mean, what's the outcome we're trying to achieve? The outcome is better education, better destinations for young people. That's the outcome that we're trying to achieve. How do we get there, though, is the question. And the Scottish Government, there's no surprise that we are committed to supporting the recruitment of teachers. And we are providing local authorities with £145.5 million to protect teacher numbers. Our ambition is clear, it's to close the poverty-related attainment gap. But I guess this is an example of an area of shared responsibility, and it's why the work on the outcomes and accountability framework is so important to go alongside the fiscal framework. So that work is ongoing, but I think it is really, really important. In terms of the Verity House, the Verity House is a and moving forward. So there are areas within the Verity House where there's specific funding, so there's £145.5 million in the local government settlements to protect teacher numbers. So that's a policy decision of the Scottish Government. I'm not sure I've heard any of the opposition parties articulating a desire to reduce teacher numbers. So we need to look at it. And I think the way we make progress is by making progress on the accountability and outcomes framework, so that we all have the assurances that we need that those policies, particularly those policies which are shared between Scottish Government, this Parliament, and local authorities and councils across Scotland are able to move forward in a way that works for everyone. But yeah,
if I just make a comment very specifically on the teacher numbers point, as part of the budget letter, when the Deputy First Minister wrote to COSLA leaders, there was a request in that they take forward very specifically a request on to establish an education assurance board. And that's very, very specifically being established to look at things like, is teacher numbers the best way to improve educational outcomes? So that was a request to COSLA leaders alongside the budget to be established in the early part of 2024.
No, thank you. I'm fully aware of that letter. They all mentioned that letter, and it's good to see that obviously progress is being made and that you're looking at it differently. I'm going to probe back into that. The question I asked was, must they retain teacher numbers? It's not about whether teacher numbers should be. You know, of course, teachers are very, very helpful, and I absolutely agree that you're right. No opposition would basically come back to you, Minister, in relation to that. But it's about declining enrolment. So how do you basically work that, and what formula, what sum do you use if the teacher numbers the pressure is put on the local authorities and the fact that they've got to retain them, but yet numbers are declining? And I've heard from many local authorities, you know, I spoke to a lot of the CEOs, and that's what they said. They've still got the pressure.
Yeah, so I think that's exactly what the Education Assurances Working Group is there to do, to take forward, where, and you know, that I think it's been set up, so or if it's not been set up, it'll be set up shortly, and that will allow Scottish Government and local government, along with other partners in the education field, to take that forward in a way that's meaningful and to get that kind of shared reality that we all want. You know, what is the right number? What is the best way to spend money? What's going to get those outcomes that really matter in terms of attainment, which ultimately will help drive down poverty levels?
No, it's good to hear. Like I said, Minister, I welcome this, and the fact that I will wait to see the progress, because it's a shame that they've still got those pressures declining when other areas are actually growing and they probably need funding as well. Just you did mention the £144 million. Obviously, the Scottish Government claimed to have funded the council tax freeze pledge by providing £144 million for local authorities in order to fulfil that pledge. However, the Fraser of Islander Institute estimated that freezing council tax alone may cost Scottish councils up to £229 million, leaving a substantial shortfall for our councils. How does the Minister respond to claims that a freeze will determinately impact on council tax base in future years, and where do you think the councils should look for savings in their budgets? What departments, areas? Yeah.
So the £144 million that we've set aside in the budget is equivalent to a 5% council tax increase nationally. So it provides the money that would have been raised by a 5% increase. If councils agree to that, then over 2 million council taxpayers will benefit from council tax freeze in 24-25, providing much-needed financial relief, particularly to vulnerable households. In terms of the Fraser of Islander figures, as I understand, the Fraser of Islander figures included an allowance for the multipliers, which there was the COSLA Scottish Government consultation on the multipliers. There was really very little support for that. We can the analysis of that's been released today, and I think out of all 32 councils, there was only 4 councils came forward saying they supported the changes to the multiplier. So you know, that was always a consultation. It was a consultation which was not supported, so it's not been taken forward. So the £144 million funds 5% increase in council tax across Scotland. I guess I've kind of heard some suggestion that some councils were talking about 10% increase in council tax, and that might have almost been able to fly last year when inflation was running at the levels it was, but inflation is expected to be around 3%. So I think it would be difficult for councils to be talking about. So I think the 5% allocation is a fair allocation for a council to fully fund the council tax freeze across Scotland. I hope all councils take that up, and I hope, therefore, all council taxpayers will benefit from that.
Thank you, Minister. If I can probe further into that, let's put the phrase Valander Institute estimate to aside. But we've actually heard from councils in here and from COSLA, and I've heard from them personally. Like I said, I've been speaking to the CEOs. They are under pressure. Whether obviously the 5% is good enough or whether it should be 10%, they are going through really challenging times at this moment. So if I was to ask you, Minister, that what sort of savings would they could they save, in what areas, what would be your examples you would say? Obviously, we know certain areas like education, social care, certain things are ring-fenced, but what areas do you think the councils need to start looking at? Because, you know, there is a massive budget gap and they are going through challenges.
So no one is suggesting there's anything easy in the budget this year. It's been really difficult decisions for the Scottish Government, Deputy First Minister in particular, looking at all of the challenges across the Scottish Public Service, and equally it will be challenging for our local government colleagues. It would be disingenuous, I think, of me to come and tell local authorities how they should allocate their budgets, and there'll be different decisions made based on local circumstances. What we've done in this budget is increase the discretionary value by that £1 million that's unring-fenced. I want to go much further than that. But it's difficult for us to go much further than that without the work on the fiscal framework and the assurance and accountability framework, which makes sure not just Scottish Government, but this Parliament has confidence going forward. And that gives us the trust that Councillor Hagman talked about, a two-way trust. It has to be two-way. And I guess that's why there is so much effort being put into those discussions with COSLA.
Thank you, Minister. I look forward to the progressive work. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Pam. I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. So we've heard previously from the Directors of Finance and COSLA arguments that budget reductions mean that councils spend all of their time and money reacting to problems rather than trying to prevent problems from arising. So I'm just wondering what your reflections are on that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to remember, was it Glasgow that kind of made that kind of point last week? But I think they're kind of selling themselves a bit short. There's kind of some amazing work going on across local authorities who are generally, and it's generally when they work in partnership with other public services that we kind of can really see the difference and some great results being achieved. I'm going to give a shout out to three local authorities where I think actually are showing the innovation that is happening across the country. So Glasgow and Dundee have the Pathfinders work, which is innovating to support families out of poverty by testing innovative models of person-centred service provision. Once that work's completed, we'll be able to look at that and see whether that can be applied to other authorities. And the model in Glasgow and Dundee are not the same; they're different. And so you would look for local adaptation to that innovation. Other places, Clackmannanshire, where the Family Wellbeing Partnership is testing and embedding wellbeing and capability approaches to tackling poverty. No one's saying it's easy to manage the budget, and that's for sure. But to suggest that there isn't time for innovation, you know, this is absolutely the time for innovation. Since I've been an MSP, we've always been talking about how we shift resources from reactive to preventative, and I think we are starting to see that work happening. It was always going to be difficult, but it is happening. You know, the work in Dundee, Glasgow, and Clarks is all about prevention, all about saving saving those individuals from trauma in the future, and therefore saving the public service in the future. Preventative work happening across the country. I gave three examples, but there are many, many more across Scotland. So, yeah.
I think I was just going to come in at a more strategic aggregate level. And obviously a huge amount of funding has gone into early years expansion, a huge amount of funding has gone into free school meals. So enormous pots of money have gone into activities at a national level which are ultimately preventative in nature.
Yeah, if I could just follow that up then as well. So I'm wondering how big a priority then will that investment in prevention and early intervention be when you're working with local authorities in the future? And clearly as well, it's something that we all know saves us money in the long term. However, it tends to be, you know, the outcomes that we're targeted on or whatever the targets are leads the direction of where the focus is. So how will you make sure that that's central going forward?
So I think we all have a role in that. Outcomes is what we want to be looking at, but still we all often find ourselves going back to what are the inputs, what in terms of either finance or numbers of X or Y, whereas actually it should be the outcomes. As a parliament, as a government, as society, we need to find a way to shift our analysis onto, you know, what's going to make the difference. And the kind of, there's a number of pilots ongoing which should help us do that. It's something that government can't do in isolation, and neither can local government, and neither can the health service. Right across the system, we need to work in partnership. But there are, as Ian said, some big ticket items where government is putting significant funding in to support work which hopefully will have prevention in the future. The Scottish Child Payment being just one huge example.
So do you see that as something that you can embed in your frameworks going forward?
I think we have to, and I think that's why the agreed three principles were so key to going forward, because and it was crucial that those principles were able of Verity House were able to be agreed across all of the parties, because preventative work it's not for right the here and now, it's for the long term. So we need to all buy into that. And I think there is politically buy-in into those principles. Clearly there's differences of how we take things forward, and that's, you know, we're all in different parties, so we kind of understand that there will be different political views on certain parts of that. But the basic principles, there appears to be universal agreement across the Scottish political spectrum.
That's helpful. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Stephanie. And I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. One of the aspirations of the Verity House Agreement was the fiscal framework we've obviously spoken about earlier would be concluded by September 2023, and that hasn't happened. How confident are you that the fiscal framework can still be agreed, and do you have any timescales of when that will happen?
So I think as Councillor Hagman said, that was an aspiration, and you know the reason that would have been good is if we'd had the fiscal framework in place, then it would by September, then it would have been able to feed into the budget, and that would have been good. But it is important that we get it right. And you know there is a huge amount of work, collaborative work between the Scottish Government and COSLA going into the fiscal framework, and that work will continue. I think, as was said, we want to get it ready as soon as we can, but it absolutely needs to be right. In the meantime, we've taken a number of actions in this budget which supports some of the principles that we expect to be in the fiscal framework around ring fencing, for example, so £1 billion being baselined. And that's really important. So, but I think it's important to recognise that it's not as easy to, you know, there's not a simple formula that we can just say, you know, I think there was a suggestion previously, you know, just take the percentage of the Scottish budget. Well, we've given local government a higher percentage of the Scottish budget this time, but it still doesn't meet the aspirations because of what we're all trying to do across Scotland's public services. So it's important, but it's important we get it right.
So no timescales in terms of maybe later on in the year, or I don't want to compress you, but it's important we get it right. I know, but at the same time,
there's a huge amount of work going on. It's not something that's in Scottish Government's gift. We're working with COSLA. It's not in, you know, there's two partners here. But Ian, is anything more we can?
I can come in some matters of process, which don't, this perhaps stops short of answering your question, but explain the situation. So we've been working with COSLA constantly on the fiscal framework over a number of years. in around May last year, we had taken papers to our political leaders, respective political leaders, to try and take forward a fiscal framework. And in that, I believe it was the end of May, COSLA leaders said they tasked their officials with taking forward exploration of a rules-based framework. That had never been discussed up until that point at the end of May. We worked with COSLA to clarify what a rules-based framework was. There wasn't a particularly clear understanding, and we discussed whether it was something like the Statement of Funding Policy, the Barnett Formula, the Scottish Fiscal Framework with the UK Government, all sorts of different interpretations of what a rules-based framework might look like. In June, we took a paper to COSLA officials that set out half a dozen different scenarios of what a rules-based framework might look like. They then took a paper to COSLA leaders at the end of September, which set out the opportunities but also the risks. There are huge risks in terms of other technical issues, things like machinery government changes. How would a formula reflect that? How would the NDR guarantee feed in? How would the Belwyn scheme operate? What would the timing of it be? What would happen with the UK budget? Huge complexities underpinning that. So COSLA took a paper to their leaders at the end of September and have now approached us to explore with them on two preferred fixed percentages of the Scottish budget. They've asked us to work with them to try and develop that. I've hopefully set out the complexity of that. That's a brutally complex ask for us to look what it would have looked like the last couple of years. It's hugely complicated by things like the COVID funding. We don't know how that would feed into the percentages. So we're continuing to work with COSLA to try and understand what a rules-based formula might look like to enable COSLA to hone an ask to ministers. At the moment, they have not placed an ask on ministers. Once they've placed that ask, we will work with ministers and COSLA, obviously, to understand how that would operate in practice. My position as the head of local government finance, I would now be looking again at September as our deadline to get it into next year's financial position. But I don't think we can understate how complex a mechanism this will be.
Thanks for that information. That kind of gives us a better understanding. Moving on to my next question, obviously we heard from the directors last week, you know, about the pressures that councils are facing, and obviously with a report as well, the Local Government Information Unit published, showing kind of real concern about the future of council finance, obviously backed up by the report published today. To what extent do you think that this budget will contribute to public services and local government finance becoming more sustainable?
So I think... I think it's good that you've mentioned the Accounts Commission report published today. I think the conclusion of that is that the conclusion I'm going to take from the report is that Scottish local government is in a very different position than local government in England, for instance. We've seen a number of local authorities effectively going bankrupt. The auditors did not identify, and I'm taking a quote from the report, any council in Scotland as being fiscally unsustainable in the short term. Clearly, we need to work to make sure that we continue that position. I think the fiscal framework will help with that. We've prioritised local government within the budget, so a larger share of Scotland's discretionary budget is now going to local authorities, but clearly local authorities will still have tough decisions to make going forward. I think part of it will be public service reform, which has to happen across service in Scotland unless something changes in terms of the quantum of budgets. Clearly this year, the autumn statement reflected a budget which had priorities of tax cuts for the richest rather than investing in public services. We've had to try to adapt to that. It was, you know, far tougher than anyone I think had expected, and it's making that's difficult for the whole of public service, including local authorities.
Thank you.
Thanks, Stephanie Callan wants to come in on a supplementary.
Thank you very much, Convener. Minister, you mentioned there about the autumn statement, and I'm wondering what your sense is. Do you feel that COSLA, local government, and maybe the public more generally, do you feel they understand the seriousness and depth of the impact that that's actually having?
I'm not sure the public fully understand the challenges of what Scotland is facing based on what was agreed in the autumn statement. You know, there was some headlines, but, you know, devastating cuts to capital, for instance, you know, 10% cuts to capital, and you know, these things can't just be wished away. We have to deal with it. We have to have a balanced budget in Scotland. That's, something that we have to do. So it's not. I think COSLA, I think local authority leaders, maybe in public, are of course that's COSLA's job to argue for local government. So of course COSLA are arguing for more money from local government. But speaking in private, to political leaders across the spectrum, I think there's a recognition of just how difficult this was. But clearly, political decisions have to be made. We're at stage one of the budget. You know, there's suggestions about how the budget could be moved forward. I know DFM will be having discussions with finance leaders of all parties.
That's helpful. Thanks. Thanks very much for that. Now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. I wonder, Joe, could I ask you about the thorny issue about multi-year settlements? It was clearly the intention in Verity House that we would try to do that wherever possible, but the constraints that you face as a government is that we don't get multi-year settlements in terms of our budget. So how do you square the two? How do you resolve this? And is there ever going to be an end to this particular debate, do you think? Because I've been hearing it for years that everybody wants multi-year settlements, but we never quite seem to be able to deliver it.
Yeah. So, I mean, we did give effectively a heads up in terms of the high level spending in the resource spending review published in May 2022, looking at Scottish budgets up to 26-27. But we are, you know, it's clear we're publishing a 1 year budget for 24-25 because, you know, while we recognise the merits of multi year budgets, the nature of the autumn statement and the OBR forecasts make future prospects more volatile, and it actually could be misleading and more unhelpful to suggest that there's some certainty about what there is going forward. We'll obviously revisit the multi-year outlook in the next medium-term financial strategy, which I think is due to be published in May 2024, but to suggest that we could promise what's coming in the future might not be as transparent as it might at first appear.
I mean, is there any progress, do you think, with colleagues in the UK government about this big issue? Because it recurs year on year. Is there any progress in that whole direction of travel, do you think?
But this year, I think, was the least transparent process that we have ever experienced in relation to discussions with the UK government about what was in the autumn statement, unheard of. And I think the scale of what came to Scotland with no discussion, and in other parts of the UK are facing these challenges too. And you will have heard comments from Welsh finance colleagues.
Okay. Let me ask you about ring fencing, unring fencing, directed spend, those issues. You've removed nearly £1 billion that was formerly ring-fenced, and you highlighted some of the policy areas that had reached. But we did hear from directors of finance last week who were a bit sceptical even of that. So I wonder, firstly, could you clarify, have you removed nearly £1 billion of ring-fenced funding and baselined it?
Yes, we absolutely have. It's just under £1 billion, and we've put that out in detail in terms of what areas we have on ring fence. I totally get that local government wants us to go further, and I want us to go further too. We have to have the outcomes, the assurance and accountability framework in place so that not just government, but this Parliament has the confidence going forward, and we can build that trust that Katie Hagman talked about earlier. That's a really important part of the work that we're doing around the fiscal framework. It's one of the work streams laid out in Verity House. We need to do that. There are many things that local government delivers which are joint responsibilities with this Parliament, and this Parliament has its priorities as well. And I guess the point would be that respect needs to go both ways, and you know, we need to recognise that this Parliament has roles and responsibilities, and we need to recognise that local government has roles and responsibilities. That's the big win, for I think, from the New Deal, would be having that accountability and assurance framework going forward, so that we have a certain understanding around what we're trying to achieve and what the outcomes that will make a difference to the people of Scotland. But I want us to go further, for sure. But we have unring-fenced nearly £1 billion. Ian, do you want to...?
The one thing I was going to come in on the ring-fenced point is The concept of ring fencing is often misrepresented, but fundamentally very little of the budget itself is actually ring fenced. I think the point on directed is more important, but by far and away the largest ring fenced funding line was for the expansion of early learning and childcare. Now that's ultimately ring fenced by statute, not by Scottish ministers per se. So the huge part of the ring fenced funding was supported by statute. So it's not always that Scottish ministers have imposed the ring fencing on local government. It is the way that the funding has evolved for the expansion of key services. That is a key thing that's been removed. It's now local authorities have far more flexibility in how they deliver the 1140 hours, but they're still statutorily required to deliver the 1140 hours, and it's therefore the flexibilities are in that space.
I mean, the discussion almost sounds as though directed spend is some kind of constraint on local government, but I always understood it to be shared priorities, commonly shared priorities. But, Minister, do you see further flexibility in that space, though, to address these issues that COSLR keeps raising?
I certainly hope so, and I think that's what we're working on, is to get more flexibility. Particularly, I mean, there are some things which, as you say, are shared responsibilities. This Parliament has taken a decision that they want school meals, for instance. But in order to deliver that, can we be less prescriptive in how local authorities do that, so they can look at their local priorities and work out what works for their local areas? So we're clearly on a direction of travel. We're not there yet. Nobody from government was ever suggesting that ring fencing would just disappear overnight. Going forward, we don't want to have ring fencing without agreement. Clearly, Pam Gossel talked about speaking to lots of council leaders. Clearly, I've been speaking to lots of council leaders as well, and often they're asking for more money for X, Y, and Z, and what they're talking about is more ring-fenced pots for specific things which they know will help their local authorities. And I absolutely get that. I come back to that's why I think an agreed fiscal framework and accountability outcomes and accountability framework are so crucial if we're going to make the difference that we want to make.
My final question to you, Minister, is basically on the capital allocation. You mentioned yourself there's a 10% cut in the capital allocation to the Scottish Government, but we ourselves have switched some capital spend to revenue in the last 2 years, and the year coming up, as far as I'm aware, about £100 million or so. What impact do you think that will have, Joe, on some of our priorities and issues that we face, particularly RAC issues in the local authority estate, particularly the school estate, perhaps, and our net zero commitments? So having a reduced capital budget, then switching capital to revenue is bound to have an impact on that, surely. Could you just give the committee a little flavour of that?
Ian, talk to the switching from capital to revenue, because that's quite complex. You mentioned RAC, so I think it's really important that we kind of just touch on that. It's kind of slightly separate. So we've previously set out that we will give consideration to funding around RAC once we fully understand the scope and nature of what we're dealing with. And you know, work is continuing to gather information across the public service. This is not something that Scotland's dealing with in isolation, so the CABSEC is in regular communication with her UK counterparts in relation to that. But in the wider capital budget, you know, 10% real terms cut, added alongside the challenges in terms of the construction supply chain, construction supply chain issues, the shortages and high inflation, all make it impossible for us to deliver on all of the capital projects that we had hoped to. There was no inflation protection of the capital budget, and as I say, we're looking at a 10% real terms fall going forward. So there was no way that local authority could not be immune from that. So it will be challenging. We need to prioritise those things which most support our wider term priorities, keeping us on a sustainable look forward. We'll need to come back to Parliament with a refreshed multi-year capital allocation projection. But as I say, focusing on the maximum impact that our capital investments can have to deliver on the priorities of government and this Parliament. But it's There's no way you can have that kind of a cut and not feel the impact. Obviously, a number of capital projects are already legally committed, so they have to go ahead, and therefore that leaves less. And so some of the cuts in other parts have been much more felt much more strongly. So I'm not going to pretend that there's a magic wand that I can make that go away, because there's not.
Ian, anything further on that, particularly the local government response to that?
I witnessed Mirren trying to explain this earlier, and I would confirm that Scottish Government and COSLA are in exactly the same space on this particular technical adjustment. So in 22-23, local government were identifying, locally across the 32 councils, were identifying funding, capital projects that they were funding using resource funding. Then the local government pay deal came along. Scottish ministers wanted to invest 260 million, I seem to remember it being, into a local government pay deal, but did not have the resource to do it. So Scottish ministers provided local government with 120.6 million of capital, which locally the councils could then use that capital to fund what was a capital investment to free up the resource to be used for the pay deal. The agreement at the time was that would happen for the first 2 years, and then in the third year we would take the capital away and give them resource to fund the pay deal. Now, councils, in a like-with-like comparison, councils could still use that additional 120.6 million of resource this year to fund the capital projects that they were funding previously, because they were already using resource to fund capital investments. Now, I'm sure they will say that's not affordable anymore, but the technical change of that switch was purely a cash flow issue in those 2 years, and it should have no impact locally on local government's capital programmes.
I'm delighted to hear that.
I think the complexity of this just shows the challenges of Scotland's current fiscal situation. My solution is that we have the full powers of a normal independent country, but we'll leave that for another debate.
Without getting into the political bit of that, I think that is there is a fact that local government have far greater flexibility in currencies, and they have far greater flexibility at the end of the year than the Scottish Government does. And in the last couple of years, Scottish Government and COSLA have worked together to use local government's greater flexibilities to support difficult decisions such as pay deals.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think I'll leave it at that, Minister.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to start with a question with regards to how Scottish Government respond to the Directors of Finances. And we've heard from a few of them during our time looking at the budget when they say that there's no more room for efficiency savings. So just wondered what the Minister would say to councillors who are now potentially looking at cuts to non-statutory services, and then another question I'll bring up.
I guess that goes back to the question that Pam Gossel asked, and there will be hard decisions made. The Scottish Government have had to make hard decisions, so I guess what I'm saying is that I'm not pretending that any council budgets will be an easy process. They will have to make difficult decisions. We've supported a local authority colleagues by as much as we can, by increasing the share of the discretionary budget that we have. So we've prioritised local government, but I don't think anyone's pretending that the settlements anywhere meet the aspirations we have. But we have the reality of what was delivered to us in the autumn statement, and we have to make a budget that works.
A lot of councils have taken decisions in the past, for example, to set up ALIOs for leisure services, which, there's reports here in Edinburgh of significant potential cuts being considered and closures, and wondered where Scottish Government are advising councils when they've taken these decisions and now potentially are looking at cutting the funding which they provide to these services, which will make them unsustainable going forward. So what different models have often suggested this is where councils take these? Are government working with councils to develop and to make sure we don't see potentially these cuts and closures?
So I know a lot of local authorities took the decisions to move their services into the kind of ALIOs in order to get a more favourable VAT response, for instance, and maybe it would be better if we managed to have fiscal arrangements, so in terms of VAT and non-domestic rates, which didn't distinguish, so we could do things whatever was actually best, rather than having to try and work around the system to make what is effectively public money circulate in a different way. But ultimately, these are decisions for local authorities to make. I know it's never easy. I would urge local authorities, particularly when looking at things, and colleagues across in this Parliament as well, when we're looking at things like leisure facilities, to make sure that we are looking at that through the eye of that preventative spend that we talked about earlier. So making sure that we are accounting for all of the benefit in terms of that spend. And sometimes I think it's more difficult, and we sometimes just look at things as a cost and don't actually manage to record the benefit to the local community and to the local authority or other service provider. But nobody's suggesting this is an easy fix. But I know a number of local authorities are actually considering bringing their ALIOs back in-house in order to be able to be more integrated with the rest of their services. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. In the Scottish Government's letter to committee, ministers acknowledge that there are significant workforce shortages and challenges, and that these are continuing to have a significant impact as well, making it often more difficult for local and national government to achieve shared priorities and those which are committed in the Verity House Agreement. So just wanted to ask, and we've touched upon this in previous meetings with regards to planning departments and workforce challenges we've seen there. Why do you think workforce planning has been so poor over such a long period now, and what can change around that? Because I don't think necessarily Verity House Agreement had a real emphasis on that future workforce planning need as well.
So I guess, and as you say, we have talked about this before, so I think there are generally three areas where there are particular pressures, so environmental health, planning services and building standards, which I think that's the kind of three where there's particular areas. And as we've discussed before, there is significant work in all three areas to improve that. So environmental health, there's obviously a lot of work ongoing, but in addition to the work that we're doing directly with local authorities, Food Standards Scotland have awarded the Society of Chief Officers of Environment and Health in Scotland £250,000 in order to provide funding to Scottish local authorities for the sponsorship of trainee food safety orders and the new qualification pathway to the higher certificate in food control. In relation to planning, we've obviously discussed this in depth previously, but we are continuing to engage closely with COSLA and the Heads of Planning Scotland to understand the pressures by planning services and action to strengthen the future pipeline of skilled planners entering and being retained in the planning sector in Scotland is a high priority for us, and it's a core part of MPF4 delivery. There's obviously a number of actions which we've talked just a couple of months ago about, so obviously there's not huge those actions are ongoing, but we absolutely recognise the challenges. And I guess the third area, again, out with my direct portfolio is building standards. And again, we're working closely with local authorities. It does seem that one of the challenges in terms of building standards is the profile and esteem of the profession. So there's a lot of focus on that. One of the specific pieces of work we have in there is the Ambassadors Network, which is helping to promote job roles and improve attraction into the profession. And there's obviously the new modern apprenticeship pathway, which was just introduced last year, is now seeing apprentices starting to come through. So we're taking action on all these three areas, obviously working in partnership with local government. It's not something that we can just take forward on our own. We have to work in partnership as you would expect.
Much, Miles. You mentioned a couple of times, so this is in relation to the fiscal framework, you mentioned a couple of times the accounts and assurances framework, and it seems that there's quite a lot of importance. You're putting a lot of weight on the development of that, and I wondered if you were in a position to give us a little bit of an indication of what you want to see in that accountability and assurances framework in terms of the relationship with COSLA and the Scottish Government.
So that's one of the work streams that is agreed within Verity House to take forward clearly it's a partnership, so we need to make sure. Ultimately, I would say an accountants framework, an assurance framework, sitting alongside the fiscal framework, to give not just the Scottish Government assurance, but also this Parliament assurance around those areas where we have shared accountability. I think part of that will be important in terms of the work that the Accounts Commission take forward. But obviously it's work that's ongoing and it's a partnership, so I wouldn't want to be too prescriptive.
For that, and thanks for coming this morning to give evidence. And I think also, Ian, it was very helpful to get the kind of background, the kind of process of the fiscal framework and the complexity that you kind of have come up against in the kind of months in trying to develop that, and also a sense that hopefully this time next year we'll be in a different position. We agreed to start at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private, so as that's the last public part of the meeting for our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.